Buon direttore, per anticipare i lavori, ieri ho visto già la sua conferenza e non ve l'anticipo chiaramente perché deve essere tutta una sorpresa, ma sicuramente posso dire che i temi che affronterà Winy sono i temi che noi nella nostra scuola affrontiamo. Devo ringraziare il signor Adolfo Guzzini, anticipiamo i lavori.
Best. Bene, bene, buongiorno a voi tutti, grazie per essere qui numerosi, d'altronde non poteva essere diversamente, è una grande opportunità avere con noi il grande architetto Winy Maas, che come già detto dal direttore dell'Istituto Fosco è chiaramente uno studio di architettura e una persona fondatore della stessa società che ha lavorato e lavora nel mondo, portando e approcciando l'architettura in un modo molto particolare, molto con una forza e una valenza e una diciamo contenuto che esprime una volontà di poter aiutare il mondo a evolversi comunque a creare nuovi spettacoli, nuove visioni e nuove funzionalità. Bene, la nostra azienda, come sapete, sponsorizza questo tipo di eventi già da 2 anni. E abbiamo una convenzione con il Maxi di Roma, Pippo Ciorra, ci conosciamo da 20 anni, grosso modo, quando eravamo bambini quasi. Ma io insomma, ecco. E onestamente riteniamo che per il lavoro che noi facciamo e portiamo, cioè la luce alla quarta dimensione dell'architettura, ma comunque senza luce non si viverebbe e non si potrebbe neanche godere paesaggi come o città urbane come questa di Ascoli Piceno, anche se non è ancora appunto nel settore dell'illuminazione, perché l'ultimo intervento non lascia desiderare qualcosa, queste sono un po' critiche sparse ufficiali, ma insomma qui siamo nell'Istituto dell'Architettura, pertanto dovremo fare il meglio per il nostro territorio. La volontà di essere qui ad Ascoli, chiaramente suggerita da Pippo Ciorra, è per noi l'abbiamo fatto con molto piacere, in quanto la sede delle Canadi è quella che poi ospita col Maxi tutte le conferenze, ma vogliamo essere a disposizione del territorio per portare il massimo contributo possibile per migliorare noi tutti, perché è con la bellezza che riusciamo a rimanere competitivi nel mondo. Pertanto personaggi come Maas non possono che farci bene ascoltandolo, capendolo, intervenendo e pertanto sostenendolo. Grazie, grazie a te Maas.
Grazie.
Buongiorno, grazie a tutti di essere qui. Volevo, è la prima volta che usiamo questo progetto di auditorium, speriamo che diventi presto un auditorium con le infrastrutture necessarie, per questa volta ce la siamo cavata, ma certo insomma faremo un corso sugli auditorium, secondo me, il prossimo semestre. Io sono molto lieto di essere qui perché in genere questo progetto che facciamo, con grazie alla generosità, all'attenzione e all'impegno della ditta Guzzini, di Adolfo e di Pier Giovanni Cereggioli, che è un, come dire, il mazzarino di tutto questo, behind the stage, e però diciamo siamo riusciti a portare il progetto Lighton qui ad Ascoli ancora più vicino ai nostri studenti. Winy ci teneva molto a parlare in una scuola e quindi questo anche ci ha aiutato a prendere questa decisione, quindi siamo molto contenti che siate qui in tanti, siamo anche contenti sotto sotto che siamo nella settimana del Salone del Mobile, così abbiamo più studenti che professionisti. Io che poi odio il Salone del Mobile, sono felicissimo di avere qualcosa da fare qui. Lo studio MVRDV voi lo conoscete tutti, è uno studio nato all'inizio degli anni 90, condivide con alcuni dei vostri docenti il fatto che in quegli anni vinsero dei concorsi Europan, come il professor D'Annunzio in quel periodo, poi dopo l'Olanda funziona il professor Mondaini, l'Olanda ha funzionato in modo un po' diverso dall'Italia purtroppo, sono nati da due costole diverse, lui e Jacob von Reis venivano dallo studio OMA,
Jacob Van Ries coming from the Arma studio and Debris from the Meccano studio. They started to work in a time in the 90s when architecture was extremely exciting. Conditions were very good. There was a good flow of money. And Holland, the Netherlands, as a country, they were committed to offer opportunities to young architects. They have been able to take the most out of this. They have built very important projects, Wozzocco residence for older people in Amsterdam, a splendid building for the Hannover Expo with different gardens. That was the first vertical garden. We can also remind the silogram on the water of Amsterdam, another project that we have used for the recycle exhibition was the silos recycling process for the Copenhagen Harbor. So a very long list of beautiful projects. And in the food, we expose Smart Hall, which is a very famous project at the moment. It is a great large market in Rotterdam, which is changing the profile of the city. So we have been working with our students on the market issue. So we are grateful to have Maas Vini with us today. So, of course, no Italian examples, for example, of interesting markets. So we had to put together examples coming from Spain, from the Netherlands. There is no quality project in Italy for markets except for a poor imitation in Rome. So Winy yesterday was extremely generous with us. They participated in many, many awards. And I remember the beautiful 2006 installation with the small houses. Winy is a teacher, of course. He teaches in Delft, in the faculty in the University of Delft. We have very strict relations with the Delft University. Yesterday, he was extremely generous in the presentation in Rome yesterday, and we are so happy, of course. So it's time for me, he says, to shut up, sit back, and leave the flair and the sport to you.
Thank you very much for your words. Grazie mille. I hope the sound is okay for everybody to can understand. So my Italian is very poor, so I have to do it in English. I'm very sorry for that, but I hope that we can come across. What I would like to do today is actually slightly different than in Roma. Because I want to, as I'm in a university here, also to take some of the, say, academic, say, scientific or pseudo-scientific parts of our enterprise. Of course, it starts with the fact that we don't build in Italy up till now, and which is an interesting point of view. I have no clue. But still, we invented something here in Italy, which I would like to share with you, in order to discuss actually all the things that came afterwards. You have inspired us, and you have become indeed a reference, as Rem Koolhaas would see, Roma is the La Città Zero, as a kind of reference for many kind of constraints, and I will come back to that. But why do we build it then somewhere else, is a question that, of course, you are also facing sometimes. I mean, I love Torino, especially because of this image, and in that way, at those moments when the games were over, and that you see, I mean, can't we make a building like that? I was asking to the director of Sao Paulo, Imi, at that moment, and he invited us for a competition, and I would know in advance that Renzo Piano would win, of course, but it's like you do it because you think, if he wins anyway, we can do what we want. So that's what we try to do, to make a project for Sao Paulo, IMI, which somehow like loves this perspective, this idea that you can look over a city, that you can see the mountains and look to Roma, look further away, and to expose a bank, which is normally very introvert, even Sao Paulo, IMI, is like somehow a part of the game. And how to make them there and then and make them more vulnerable was actually the option that we would like to pursue. So how to do that? Because this was the question. When you have this street here, one tower, make a next tower, is what it wants to do. Oh no, can you do that? Why two towers in this moment, in this way, in a kind of, as it happened, in insane ugly way. Because you compete always with the monument of Torino, which is at that moment there. So how to deal with, what is the best combination between the monument and us? With the Sao Paulo, IMI, and say the history. So in the first meeting with the CEO, we said, maybe we can do this. And that, so then you have a good like sister, brother. And you are in the air, you're vulnerable, and you have a fantastic piazza below in that way. And a little bit shadow in that way. This is a joke, no? No, I'm serious in that way, and I'll come back to that later in the lecture. No, you can't do that. So back to the drawing board. And he said, yeah, but this here, no one can see each other. Well, if I want to see the banker, I want to say hi, or I want to collaborate with it. So what we do, we opened it in a very hard, but yeah, a vertical organization, that is completely 19th century. Yeah? That is not happening anymore. So we said, why can't you make a horizontal organization? Yeah, but where is my tower? He asked. I want to have a tower. So, okay, we can combine. So this is, that's the moment to do that. Yeah, but how to do that? And that's quite easy. You make better windows also to Bologna and also to Lyon, and then you give some columns and done is what it wants to be. So I think, if it works, this is, yeah, there it is. In those days, we didn't have good renderings. So it was not yet, the technology was not there. But here you see the story. I still love it because it's kind of rough, eh? To open the tower, to make it horizontal organization. Because I need the end of the film, that's why I need it. To leave it up, to have the view, to make these windows towards Roma and towards Frankfurt, to make columns, and to love the piazza. To make more windows to the other sides, so you can see it from everywhere, is what it wants to do. Even to the sky, and of course also from below. We need to control bankers, is this building want to say. And at that moment, where you come then down, then somehow this element, this new floating bank, loves the portico più grande, the Torino at that moment. And where it becomes the dance floor of that environment. So of course we translated into travertine, because that was demanded, and to have this kind of piazza where you could see, you could look up and be in the heart of the bankers above you, and then have this kind of, say, trading floor, where the dealers would talk with New York and with Frankfurt and with Hong Kong in that way, and that would celebrate it in this best manner. What a pity we didn't get it. Excuse me, but the building that has been made is not good. And it's and I hope I can, I don't know if Renzo is in the audience, but I really want to talk with you about that. What this building wants to say is basically, what's the relationship between architecture and the city? It wants to be not stupid, it wants to be somehow intelligent, it wants to push it a little bit, how to criticize, how to be in communication. I cannot. If you are only like silent, and you become thump, autistic, what is that? What does it make sense to work on that? So architecture and the city have a very intense and beautiful relationship that I would like to express. Of course, that's like very old. So also we have to wonder what could be the next step in this relationship. Huh? We can talk about the next city generation and that we should engage. And yes, I love cities for many reasons. Because they are dense and they therefore create more space. They create more interaction. You are close to each other, so you can talk now with each other in that way. And it creates also more symbiosis, climatically, culturally, and economically. And what's the next after this observation? The next step is that we want to have a kind of shopping list of desires. That's 2016 at the moment. That our cities are obviously green. That they're obviously diverse. That's why I love Europe and its open frontiers. And it should be specialistic, so that you somehow see that Roma is different than Milano, that etc. Why? Because then you can encourage depth. You can go also to other cities. You love to go, and it becomes more trade in the end. So you need to be energetic, don't sleep. You need to be dense, accessible for everybody. You need to be historic. You need to be lovely and beautiful. And you need to be free. If not exciting, and in the end, of course, democratic. I'm a, by nature, I'm a democratic in that way. So how to deal that? And I want to give you three levels of, say, discussing that, of this relationship between the building and the city. To do that on a research level, to do that on an urbanistic level, yes, urbanism still should exist. I'm aware that there are not so many urbanists in the, on the planet, and especially there are not so very many sexy urbanists as such that draw or that make visions in a kind of better way. So I plead enormously for education like you, that you expose yourself even better and more profound in a way. And last but not least, also some architecture for those that love architecture in the audience. So let's go for the research part. I take you to the Y Factory, and some of you might know it. We made this tribune where we, underneath the professors, on the roof, the students, so that they can talk, then that they can look, and that they can start to discuss. You have to ask questions. You have to criticize. If you don't do it, then nobody will do it. So how to train our people in that way, that they start talking and make reasoning and argumentation is, I think, a key part of our business. And of course we have to make models. Of course we have to visualize that. That's our power also. So we do that also by talking, by selling, by discussing it with our mayors and with our ministers in that way. And we produce, of course, piles of books in that way, piles of information. Well, it's not that high yet, don't worry. But I love that student work, even at master education level, not only PhDs, because that takes too long, 7 years almost, so to bring that together so that they can speak out, everyone, as part of, say, these researches that we would like to do. We try to make only imaginations about future cities. Yeah, you have to specialize. Every professor should do something different. And I plead for not too many professors in the world. Because not because of competition or losing competition, but the fact that we can, it's better in a university to have a smaller amount of professors with more assistants around it, because then you can be more deep. And you are specializing. You do something different here than in Roma or in Milano, is what I would like to propose. And I know there's a huge defense system. Eh? Professors stay there for the rest of their life, if not longer. And so they, yeah, what can you do? Then you splinter your observations. And I think that is very, I find that very difficult in Europe that is happening. That is not happening in the medical research. That is not happening in the chemical research. Why do architecture organize itself in such a kind of splintered, stupid way? I don't understand what we are doing in that way. So we do this model, this future city in three ways. On one hand, we make a model city, simply 1 million people, and you change an abstract city, and you change one parameter. For instance, I want to have a city with wolves inside. How can I accommodate wolves? I have to open up our city in order to do that. One example, or when there are sky cars involved in that way. The second element is the viewing and applying it on different situations, also with the sponsors or the political promoters that are there. And in the end, we gather it in a game, basically, in a kind of interactive momentum. The controller starts now in August, this complete, say, work of this parameterized instrument as the best archive that I can imagine, beyond the books. So to give you some ideas of some of the researchers, I'm not going into more of them. This comes out very soon. This is a trailer for a moment to buy it in the future, because now with this copy guide, you can really copy everybody better. And then you can improve, you can all become masters in an easy way, is what this book is going to say. This is how we do it for the Netherlands at the moment, what it should do with its headlines, but what's next. I take you to three researches for a moment. One is, of course, that everyone wants to believe that we should be green. No problem about it. This book was mentioning, like many observations on greenness. I'm not going into that, because it's that's for reading. But it proposed also a calculator, and I come back to that later, because that is now applied in some of the cities, in a way. A calculator that is multilingual, that is not only LEED and BREEAM, but also five-star system in one go, so that you can communicate with each other and can calculate the greenest city. So we did that, and this is the greenest city on the planet. It's better than Masdar, but it looks quite boring, no? It's like, this is really Dutch, you could say. And so what to do about that? So this series of, say, collaborations with patent holders is what we do with many universities now, to extend their product, to make it even better, that product, and to give it an urbanistic meaning. That's all. So what can I show? For instance, this one. This is a section of a crop rotator. So, say when you produce salad and you do it like this, then you have a matter, more efficiency. Okay. You can bring that up to somehow, for the moment, to 2 meters high. So what we try to do to make it 20 meters high. Because to create more efficiency in that way, and with other kind of speed. And then try to apply it over our roofs in that way. And so we propose it, of course, for Barcelona, because then you have a nice green city, of course, and then we get rid of this kind of Gaudi obsession. Another product, this is concrete that loves water, that in a way harvests water, harvests the dew that is there, that can happen around the concrete. This is a very nice product. If you do that in tropical circumstances, tropical circumstances, you can collect them enormously. So this is the proposal for Cairo, to imagine new pyramids of water, basically, that is in that way, and beat with Giza in the best way. Or this one. In this water, you can see it here, there are different levels of microbes. Microbes can be activated, some of them, through electricity. Put some electricity in the water and they start to glow. That's gorgeous, because what happened in that case, then the Amsterdam becomes really beautiful in that way. And we don't need our lanterns anymore. And it feels, I want to swim in Amsterdam, almost. That is what I wanted to say. So that's another test that we're doing. And this one is under production. The students that did that are in, yes, they have a nice patent again. So they it's basically collecting solar power, but then putting it into a device that turns and that finds the best, say, composition. So they worked it out and in that way, and then they made this kind of images that went over the planet. And suddenly this kind of water lilies become like beautiful. They touch this kind of avatar feeling, and it becomes, and that is nice that now in Phuket and in Hong Kong, that they want this, and they want to test with that, to have this in front of the bay. Suddenly, when architecture becomes sexy, it accelerates greenness, it goes beyond the boredom of data, but it uses the data in that way to make it believable as such. So what is next? I take you to the Paris city, because some of you might have visited the Biennale in Venezia where we showed this, but I want to explain it as a method to encourage research in that way. And I show you the latest stand of the art. So what is happening? These are towers. And most of these towers are ugly, to be honest. They are stupid, they are autistic, as I said before. You have to go in, up, and out again. But they don't do anything for the city. They don't do anything for the collective as such. So what we're investigating, if you have a tower like this, and you open it slightly, what is this opening act meaning? Opening a tower means basically it becomes more porous, it gives place for vegetation, it gives place for the collective, for talking, for access, and for cooling, in the end, for ventilation. So how can we work with that in that way? How far can we go and what motifs can we do? So we made this film. Let me see, here it is. Oh, there it is, sorry. Where every, say, group of students worked on one step. One, they start with a tower and you open it in the middle. Like this is this pregnant woman, basically, that we can see, to create a collective. And every step calculates how much it costs in money, in place, and in validation. Here the twister, how that could look like. Or this, the group twister, how we can imagine. Or the ones that make neighborhoods with this, with openings in the very middle. Or this here, the cactus maker, that starts to split towers so that they become different, say, views between the people. So every step by step is a sequence. From this, it's more Italian, then to this one, we can imagine so different, say, ways and motives to do that. And here, of course, this student was fired afterwards. So you have different kind of, say, examples. That leads to series, from zero to maximum of balconies, from zero tower to opening it up in the bowl series, to maximize, say, all this kind of, say, balconies or bay windows that we could imagine, to deviate our towers, to turn it into landscapes, to turn it into parasites. And we could create maybe this plan of making this army of towers with the flip book on the left and the army before us. And that we could be then shown and travel over the world. And if I go then deeper into that, then I see, I always dream, and I said it yesterday also, if we had Wall Street would look like this, if Manhattan would look like this, it would be more scientific, because it's like a series of elements, it would be more beautiful and more, here you see the lineup of the pregnant towers in that way, you see the view through the ball series from nothing to collective, to flat, the parasites, how they grow over it, the neighborhoods, yeah, this is a nice one. And I know this will be copied in a while, because what it is, you can terrace by terrace can walk from the bottom to the top, and then of course for the balance you need to go back. But of course it's a tower that would be very polite. I mean, I dream to position this, of course, opposite the Bosco Verticale, so to have then a very polite way of saying that I have a lovely colleague in that way, and also to add a forest over there, etc. So here you can see the different examples, and what kind of, even Frank Lloyd Wright is in it, that turns into this. So what's the next step afterward? I try to go from one extreme to the next extreme, because every extreme, you solve it, you're done with it, you have knowledge, but it poses immediately a next question. It's like what I call the sinusoid of research, and that how can I do in this case, with that series, we had a post-scripting, and how can we do with a pre-scripting environment, where you invent the rules and the relationships before it. So you see that happen. For instance, with the stairs option, you have this kind of, say, parameters. You connect them, as you do also here in the school, with your grasshoppers, and then you start to invent what that will be. You connect the points like this, you combine it with the housing units, in this case, and then you have stairs. And if you do that in an optimized way, with structure, then I get a tower which is more beautiful than any Escher drawing, in that way. And that somehow would be lovely to make, that is open, that is porous, and it wants to generate collectiveness in that way, and beyond that. Or when you want to make landscapes. So the same parameters, you start with floors, with landscapes, start to connect them with between them, and use program for that in the same manner. And then I get this. Then I get towers where I have grottos, and grottos connect with the other grottos. So it goes down to this tribune feeling, and that they become also stable again in that way, what it wants to see. I would dream about such a tower somewhere in that way. This was student work, which was top. And then you can continue. There are many scriptors, many exercises that we made in order to make this, and then again to compare them with each other and to show it to the world. These are sculptures, and there's pseudoscience in it. I'm aware, it's not complete science. So the book will tell you more if we do that also with structure, how much steel is involved now, how much air is involved, and will come out in a couple of, months as such. Of course, we cannot go on with that. So here you see a test, of course, that we, because if for one tower, I need 3 students for 3 weeks, 24 hours a day to make it. Yeah, it's impossible. So this guy is doing it now, and that makes it then in the end better to, it's also more European, I would say. So of course, that means that basically our work or our is this what we're doing. Some of you are doing it, I saw it downstairs in your labs, to work, and it's quite easy to do. So please buy a robot here next time, and a couple of them to do that in that way. This one was, don't worry, it's easy, eh? After the film Gravity in LA, they didn't use it anymore. And so we could use it now easily with a couple of universities to get these things done. You see it with Greg Lynn, how we're doing that. So what is next? This is a sequence of, say, what I call the porosity factor. And that is somehow what we learned in Torino, and then somehow abstractized. That's what it wants to say. So there is a ping-pong game between reality and say, abstraction as such. But now, I'll show you something weird, maybe. Maybe not. Here it is. Give me a minute. Barba. I love Barba at the moment. Why? Barba is a beard, of course, but it's like the poster was showing. But it's it's something about Barba Papa and Barba Mama. So I start with Barba Papa. Barba Papa is this book, and it is basically this. It is what we do with Axo Nobel and with BASF is to use rubber that can electronically change, and that can change its density, this rubber. So you make it for hearts, artificial hearts. So if you do that, you can thicken it, become structure, or you can open it and it becomes a basin to wash your hands in that way, or it can take light even through it in the future. You have to make it, and you can make furniture below, and of course it's fantastic that the neighbor below has a cupola at that moment. So, and if you thinnen it even more, it becomes, that was the dream. Of course, there's a logic behind it. Am I watching television, and my wife comes at home, then we do it together, and this sequence shows how much space I need. I take a shower in the morning, and we go then at the same moment away. There we go. We don't need the rest of the house. The house can shrink. It's stupid to keep these kind of big, ugly monsters everywhere in our periphery. And even then, the offices, of course, that are empty, can then, okay, there's one guy working, we can make it, we can start to work together. So there is a sequence of, say, space that we should evaluate. And this book tries to calculate how much waste of space we have. In our attempt to densify, this, I think, is a next step to organize ourselves. And it's not only us, it's also our neighbors in that way, how they are dealing with that. So you see how neighbors react in this primitive, say, collage to see what could happen. And there's a moment that I love in this sequence, in this film, is, say, when you see here all the neighbors happening, and then this is happening. There. 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 What happens here? Is that possible? That I make an apartment building where things go through? You have to compare it when you go to IKEA and you throw your kit in this ball zone, all these balls there and other kits are there, and you poof, the other kits don't feel it. It goes like, it dampens out, is what this material is doing. So there's much more flexibility than I thought before. So what's next? And then we asked, say, because we made a sequence of this element, and this is the what we call the questionnaires film. Of course, it's a contribution to one of the nicer filmmakers in the 30s, that's clear. So you have a body, you have a person, and he sleeps. Well, how much space does he need? So we make this film on top of it. Claustrophobia? Yes, I know, don't worry, we come back to that. So he wakes up, he needs more space to go around, he wants to view, and the material pushes him up, like Charlie Chaplin's Modern Times. Well, there it is. And he stands and starts to walk. So that is what we ask from BASF. Can you make that material doing that? Our software engineers have to do that in that moment. This is also nice. How much space do I need before myself? And when can I leave the space behind? Is what is questions. I will show you the research, what happened afterwards in this case. Or when I look up, how fast does it accommodate to internal views in that respect? Of course, I want to have light, that's clear. And how to make light is my question, of course, to you. I love that we could stand like this in that way, and then zzz, and there would be different patterns of light, is what we dream about, and that you can come in. That is how things could adapt. So we have to find something that we can direct through voice or through our movement to make this movement possible. He walks further. I'll take you first. So every student makes one piece. This student loves his son. It was clear. But the moment is fantastic when these teams match. How can I make material that matches open itself in a fraction? Is what it can, it's doable. Electronically we can do that. Oh, this one is fantastic because water comes like this to you where you want. You wash your hair and wherever you want. So I don't need pipes anymore because the material does it themselves. And of course it can gather and you can swim wherever you want, is what it wants to say. And here it goes to a direction. I want to show this part because it has an interesting, say, philosophical consequence at the moment if you do that. So here, swimming and swimming and swimming, he gets light, no problem. Take you to the section. So the question is, what is here moving? Am I moving or is the city moving? Is what it questions. So there is a moment, if this happens, that place has another definition in that way. Yeah. He needs to shit, so he goes away, water goes up, and then we make, of course, a shower that is better than Peter Zumthor's one in Vals, and that would be much more beautiful. Also. Oh, this is also, this is a project with Dirk Bickenbergs, where we try now to imagine also clothes with that. If you can do the same, I can do any type of clothes. Jeans, no problem. Gucci, no problem in that way. And so, and that comes to you, and you pick it up. And the film is not complete in that way. The next step we do that is that it comes to you. Of course, I don't have to do this anymore. That I hate that in the morning. So, and that is what it starts to accommodate. So you can continue this by question by question. What should that material do? I want to show you one element still, because that is with. Our chef cooks, that is one, yeah. So, also, stuff comes to you, bananas, spaghetti, but the heating up, the collecting water, and then boiling this water will be fantastic in that way. That will be the best restaurant. Sicilian, no problem in that way. We can prearrange that and come to you in this connection, and we get the different view for that. Watch it further on YouTube, and you can see that. But this is the start for another research. So I show you how, for instance, PhDs are working on this Muybridge captures, which basically start to analyze how much space I need when there are certain volumes. So you have a volume, you have a space, and you try to calculate how much space, how long do you keep it behind you in that way. And you mirror it to the front, so then you know how much you need before you. In it. That's basically the concept of this movement study as such. And that is then the next step in our mood. But what is next? I think this one is nice also. So we start at the moment, I'm happy to announce that we have some budget for that also, with what we call the magic carpet, with Vitra. So you have basically filled with chicken wire in between, and then you can indicate with and still with motors, not with, as a test to see what the carpet can do. And then you can, it can become a table to hang out. This is a critical moment. Or to sit on it. How much stuff do I need to make that stable is what this test the coming year is going to do. And I can lie down, etc. No problem. This is a dream that I would like to realize the coming. And it takes a hell of an effort to make all these motors doable and to get this magic carpet over there. And then I can start to work, of course, on rooms like this. And here's some images of what a felt room could be like to start with. And what, of course, is needed is to activate this felt. So here, the first test paid by a Swedish lady, she's 85 years, has a castle next to Gripsholm, and said, I want to pay you some of this. I want to have that in the house. So this is the napkins for her dinner. So when there's a dinner there, the other napkin reacts to you, and you communicate on the table with each other in that way. Why? It's a matter how action and reaction is going, is what we could test with this case. Then I go further in that way to the talking wall, same castle. And so how can we then also make the vertical component in it? So there are different tests. I'm not going to show them all. They're based on a very simple technology to start with, the sound wave activation. And there's nice patterns of user voices. This is the specs behind it, so you can make it. That's what I want to say. Simply low tech. And it's the new stuff that you can find. So here we have our PhD again, one of them. He's nice, huh? He starts nice, of course. Okay. He loves his wall. And he's thinking, okay, start a bit of communication, and the wall reacts in that way. He's not happy with that, with the reaction. He starts to yell, the wall becomes angry in this case, and starts to protest against that. So we could prescript all this. Of course, is this now hell or is this beauty? Is a question that we could discuss. But it's there. Even the ones that are against will lose, because it will anyway will be happening, is what we said to show. So we go on. Coming year, Barba Papa house. And of course, where is Barba Mama in that way? So what is next? This is only rubber. So we need also plants to be and birds to be in it. So we just start in the Floriade lab this idea how we can make strata of say biodegradable stuff and that produces biomass also in the same flexible way. So that's what it is. And it every time one hypothesis, every time a next step, and every time a future is what this new cities could be. And indeed, nightmare or dream, I suppose, is then a question, but it creates knowledge step by step in that relationship between between architecture and between the city. Now I take you to the next step, chapter. I take you to urbanism. Because yeah, that to defend that urbanism is cool in that way, and there are people, and maybe the next show in the Maxi will say urbanism is shit, but it's the Japanese people are very desperate on it. But I do agree that there is a role to play for you here in this environment. Let me say what can we talk about the larger scale? And we have Europe, and I love Europe. That's why we are here. Europe is nice also because of this. It has incredible amount of towns, small towns of 100. They have an incredible amount of history, sometimes maybe too much in a way. And that's what, and mayors love this. They love to be, to have a castle, to have some cute houses. That is what, but they want also that you walk in those cities. That's Europe. They also love that you have a metro line. I mean, even in small cities at the moment, we want to have metro lines or tram lines. This is super hot. Everywhere tram lines in Europe at the moment. And that you bike. Those are, so that is nice, that we try to add things to our agenda. But on the other hand, this is our world for 60% in Europe. There's a tremendous amount of shit, again, that has been produced. And also Italy has a lot of it, to be honest. And we call it the Lidlification of Europe, so that you have gradually, cheapness is everywhere, and how to deal with that, is, and how to combine that with that metro line, in a way. You see the results at the moment, that our inner cities are extremely expensive, and very worth, and then on the other side, these peripheries are extremely poor, and this bifurcation is happening more stronger than I thought over the last years. So there's work to do in order to balance that. So we need politicians, I hope there are a lot in the room here, to talk with each other. Architectural is political, no problem. And I think urbanism is political. But why not? Why are we afraid of politics? Why are we talking only about autonomy of architecture? Only about transparency? Only about mystical sources? About complexity and about other kind of zones and contradictions, of course. So let's do something also in more actively on that agenda is what we would like to propose. Funnily, if you go to the US, which has this kind of urbanism, this is really awful. All the streets in the US end in cul-de-sacs, is what it wants to say. The urbanism in America is an urbanism of dead ends. So that is okay. But now they gradually make this. They make this in Los Angeles. What is happening over there is what we could see. So another one, what happens in Asia, which is based on rawness and on about infrastructure. And if I go to Nagasaki, I see this. It's not Amsterdam. If I go to Shanghai, then I am biking through Copenhagen almost, or I'm visiting Germany at that moment. So there is an incredible, say, love for Europe happening. So we have something by tradition, by awareness, qualities that somehow are not so bad in that way, and that we could use to make our cities better and those of them also. So we have a market. Basically, you, with your knowledge, go to Shenzhen and transform Shenzhen, is what it wants to say. So what's next in that way? Of course, you know this project in Paris, where we worked with our client in Hollande at this very moment on Greater Paris. I show it because I think it's still a nice project to show. And it's continuing. It takes a long time, 8 years ago. And now, but I show the consequences a little bit. Because we think Paris is beautiful, it is, but 90% is, it's like Milano, or it's like, this kind of, you don't want to go. And you see the problems at the moment with the fights in the milieu. And so there's something to do over there. So we address this, look, how to make an agenda for our architecture by referring to Kyoto, by calculating how much space we need that on the planet, by advocating not that you should go do less, you should do more in order to activate this process and this progress in a way. So that is what it wants to say. And we give the first cadeau, the gift to Sarkozy was a calculator. I mean, it's not very romantic, I'm aware, but it way shows how he could think about the performances of his city. So, which was striking to see, because density in Greater Paris is super low, lower than Berlin. Tourism is okay because of Versailles and because of Disney, but the density of work is again super low. Poverty is there in that way. And then it's interesting to see, because the public transport is not bad in Greater Paris, but still they don't use it. Only half of the population use it. The rest drives cars. It's the same ratio as in Los Angeles that we are facing. And that was shocking to aware. So if there's a, if you say, how good are you? Then you get this map. So good points and extremely weak points. If you compare that with other kind of cute cities of Europe or further away, that creates an agenda, a program. I want to improve that, how to do that. It gives an argument for you as architects to draw something which makes sense in that way. And what, so here we calculated what to do in 20 years. So we need something like this amount of forests and water development to compensate the oxygen loss. We need this energy, this amount for the roads, etc., for habitats, for economy. This is my second gift to Sarkozy. Please, take it. And now, open the box and then do something with it. So I'm happy to announce that currently this National Forest of Grand Paris is under production on the southwest side beyond the Saclay Plateau. So that is a nice effort. I love that project as such, how that can happen. The second one is the energy project, two laws. One, to concentrate windmills on the Plateau de Saclay, which becomes a monument of air at that moment. And secondly, the law that says that every roof has to be covered by solar panels. It's very easy, this law. It takes you an hour to make that letter and to bring it through the parliament. Well, slightly long. But it is nice because that transforms all the roofs of Paris into this kind of black sea of panels like that. Of course, infrastructure is still an investment. And I come back to that, how to pay that. One of the projects that we are working on is this stupidity. All the trains end in Paris. Gare du Nord, Gare d'Austerlitz, Gare de Lyon. And then go into a taxi, an hour and a half through traffic, go to the next train. How can they do that? Of course, it's the center of the world, so you kind of allow for that. It's how Paris behaves. So this simple project to make it into connections and to avoid les rocades, the traffic around it, is basically what we're trying to do. How to make that, how to calculate it, how much does it cost to make this connection and to make a new Grand Gare dans la Place de la République, evidently. The most important symbol, as has been shown recently in this terrible accident in Paris, that should be also the place to meet, to where the periphery comes up and where we all start to share each other. That's the Grand Carrefour de l'Europe. If evidently that could be there, is what we try to do. And then we go further. Of course the banlieue should be not this, but something like that, so that we can indeed create a more... but also Haussmann should be solidaire. The poor guy from the past, he should somehow get one extra story on top of it. Just 5 meters, I can make new solar panels, but this creates so much tax value, so that I can sponsor 2 metro lines to be paid with that. So this simple act. And you do it in a very egalitarian way, so no one can be against. That is what this project is doing, and Anne Hidalgo is pursuing with this anyway. So there is a list of projects that you can do. And if you bring them all together, all based on this kind of some of these kind of logics of the new cities, then I make this is my new map of Paris. These are all these opportunities to do that. And then actually what I do is too much. It becomes better than the target. So we can only use half of it already. So Paris, instead of plus grand, deviendra plus petit. That's what we try to do. And this is the score, and here how this Paris plus petit project in the end could be done. So big through smallness is a smart technology. We know that. There are a lot of people that use that strategy to do that. But you need both. Otherwise, you become solitude and you don't know what you're doing, is what this project is saying. So what's next? And I'm happy then to bring you to Bordeaux and how we, you know, urban planners have to be among people. That's what you do, baby. You bike around, talk with everyone. No, pas comme ça. No. Okay, and where is this? It's that side. It's the other side of Bordeaux that we are treating. Bordeaux is bobo. It's cute. So you go there, it's nice, and you go to the river, and you know, UNESCO on one side, shit on the other side. So you see then Napoleon left there, cute buildings, horrible 80s and 90s and zeros in that way, and how to deal with that. So an operation like this, we plan this eight ZACs, these zones, that somehow conquer the La Rive Droite. And that changes from this into this, I'm aware. So you could have said maybe it should be completely different. Bordeaux decided to copy itself. I think it's nice to do that. You can't do that at other places in that way. So how to do that? By being intense, by loving the history, by being mixed, and by being... This was the crucial diagram. Being intime. Can you do that? Is that possible? What is the goodness about intimacy? Is a question that an urbanist can ask. Because you're close. So you can immediately react on me if they can do that, is what it says. Of course, there's many laws that are against that. You want to be green also, there should be green in between us, in that way. There's a place needed for energy, for connections, but also for light. I show the consequences of that paradox. So here, the first part is how we make the new passerelle together with an artist, nice. But that's not the issue here, too. There is a lot. So there are rails, there's Napoleon, there's the SNCF. We say we don't choose. We love them all. What monument is better? Can you give me a definition? And you as Italians, you are the masters of monuments. You conquer UNESCO with everything. I worked for UNESCO, but with about 90% of Italian architects and engineers. To calculate that. Anyway, so let's keep everything, build on top of it, don't worry. Then make a road around it, 6 meters wide. That's enough for everything. And then you can build the rest. Okay, with what? So this is our new, say, pavement. 50% of ruelle, shared space, to make that. And that, yeah, it looks a bit like that. Anyway, it's not bad. And funny, and they love it over there. So here you can see it, and it adds this kind of Amsterdam feeling, so that you live on the ground floor, is what it wants to say. So how to do that? One consequence is that the tramways, I had to split. Normally you go like this, but now you can't do that, you have to put it like this. I had to change the French law for that, because it's by traffic engineering divided. Took a long time, but done. So then we can make the buildings. This is too high. And then we're going to shave these buildings. 45 degree angle for sun to live on the ground floor, looks like that. The nicest shapes I've ever seen suddenly come appear by hazard, by coincidence in that way. And even if we do a lower angle because of Bordeaux, then it shaves it even more. And then we start to contextualize, get some extra streets in it, add the pocket parks, and have 150 architects working on it, is what it wants to be. Okay, then we have to open our courtyards because of ventilation. We add solar panels, green on the roofs, water systems that are absorbed by the roofs in the same moment, and that's it. And now, yeah, now everyone can build. You can do what you want inside, as long as you do this. That's all what it does. So you see it happening, how you extrude, how you cut it, shave it more, and how all the treatments are leading to this kind of, say, sequence, and ultimately you have this, and more or less. And if I do it on this side, same thing. And then we show how it is going to be in Bordeaux, how on the other side this will come now, with these, the roofscapes that are there, that are surprisingly, and maybe even competitive with Roma in that way, and that somehow wants to be small, you see the scale, and intense, and lightful. That's what it wants to be. And of course, this passerelle is nice. You always can put it up, and you can forget La Rive Droite if it doesn't want to be part of Bordeaux, if that is the case, is of course a symbol of that operation. So what is next? Two urban agendas is what I showed to this. I take you to give you another kind of agenda and how it translates into our architecture. And this is again a contribution to Stefano about a city next to Amsterdam, which is super poor. All the poor people were moved to the city in a new town for this kind of production. You hate it at the moment that you see it. And it's so what to do with this stuff? The people bought it just 10 years ago. You can't touch that in a moment. So we have to, and it's a plan, like also you have been doing, garden cities. That can be nice, living in green, but the green is extremely dangerous. You don't dare, as a woman, to go through this jungle around it. So we have to do something about that in order to do that. Anyway, we accepted it, because I think it's also very specific. It's different than Amsterdam. It's different than Rotterdam. And you can do work with it. So we work on Almere 2.0. So this is all the development of the garden cities that are there, and we add five of them. And we moved, say, the old diagram of Howard into this. More connectivity, more differentiation is basically what we try to do. So you control each other in that way. How to do that with the existing matter? We make, basically, we don't touch the existing. We only make new things in between. Is what it's going to do. How to understand that? One metro line that connects five garden cities. That's nice, because now we can make five new garden cities. Wow, what's the relationship between word garden and city? What kind of architecture comes out of that? This is the line from Amsterdam, comes up here, and then it goes through, and it cuts through the different, say, compartments. This is the first stop in that trajectory. And it is basically in a lake. A lake which, as I explained yesterday also, looks like coffee. It's brown, it's dark, it's terrible. It's not pristine at all. So how to clean this stuff? There was a hydrological problem, clearly. So we make a big pit, we make a Hoover that gets rid of all the chalk. I will not go into the technical details, though it's nice. It's invisible. And then clean it with our city, with our 20,000 houses, and surround it with reed. There it appears, like Atlantis in this area. We learned from Italy. We learned from Venice. Venice could have been also somehow using its laguna also in another way, what it wants to say, instead of dams. We could have swampened it out. Complex situation. Hydraulic, too late, of course, in Venice, but somehow we try to learn from that. The next stop, we go further, make an expo of housing to invite Amsterdammers, richer people to come. We go to the city center and we make around this lake an extension with a new green, say, hill that makes a kind of extension of the university and of the city center. And we end maybe in this area, which I showed in the last Biennale with the Freeland film, where we now it's agriculture and we combine it with housing in a kind of free way. That's what it wants to go to do. So what's next? I only give you one example of that, because that is what is happening now in the very moment. Almere Floriade. It is on this spot. It is one. Okay? It is a comment on the Milano World Expo, to be honest. And so again, a reference. Thank you very much, Italy, for giving me this opportunity to do that. And because what can we learn? This is an expo on flowers. And that's happening every 10 years in the Netherlands, and you can do something with that. So this spot, what to do? So here, on the left side, my city, on the right side, Rems City, Almere Centrum. So here, a battle of generations is going to happen, and it looks like this. I look to OMA plan like this, and this skyline. Nicely built, no comments, honestly very well done. But I'm asking if, when I'm on Rems plan, I look to the other side, I can see this is the basically what to do. How to do that, this next step in greenness? Here you see the urban plan that we made, just a handkerchief that demonstrates in a, maybe a brutal, but in also in an autonomous way, yes, what we can do. It wants to be scientific, so that's why the Floriade Lab that starts now is important, that to understand the relationship between plant and human being, between animal and human being. Up till now, we design only products for about 0.2% of ourselves, only for us. There are 99% others around us, like these animals and plants, like the bacteria, that deserves design and attention. So we try to do that, and we can do that with tulips, we can do that with wisterias, we can do it with ivy, this is a very nice building, we can do it with birch trees, bamboo, tomatoes, and yes, we use some of our fantastic ancestors to make that possible. So how to do that? So there will be a landscape architect, there will be an architect and an artist working on it. Every spot, 1,000 plots. You get a species. You choose. Forsythia, you get it. And you make a building, and you add some healthy systems and the path, and that's it. So what happens then? You get this composition of difference that was well happening. So where indeed the Belgian pavilion will do something different. And every pavilion will stay. Well, we don't want to have tents that go away. Italy, you are going to make a house for Dutch people afterwards. They buy that crazy house of you in that way. And that house will be placed in a specific section. So we dream this combination of program and plants. A good sports hall look like this. A good training center and a good discotheque can look like that. You sleep, of course, in a very good Dutch way. And you have bath in green. And you can do that in many ways. That is what we try to curate, and then to manipulate this curation so that it forms this city as such, with mini plots, 20 by 30 meter only. And you make what you want inside, as long that I only see the interpretation of that plant. And I cover your architecture with your plants. Don't worry, there's no discussion about architecture at that moment. So that's also done at that moment. This is how we cut out the existing and how it is. This is the plan of this city, 65 hectares. And these are all the clients, all the species. And they all get a betula, you know, brassica. We treat them as a kind of beauty as such. And we place them alphabetically, of course, how to do it differently. From A till Z, from azalea to zenobia. It will be at that moment placed. And of course, the Italian section is under the I plants. And Belgium is under the B. You get the Berberus, which fits perfectly with them in that way. And then this is the buildings that we are making. This is the streets that are appearing. This is the skyline that I promised to you. And here are the buildings again on the boulevard that will be over there and how it will be shown to the world as such. How the model is made, how it travels down with the canals through in the marina, the mini streets, the campsite, the grottos, and the people that are working on it is what he wants to say. So here, yes, you can make it. Oh, why Milano didn't do it like that? Why it has led to this stupid food court that you have given to the world? Why was there almost nothing to see? And was it still so successful? It's one of the biggest mysteries that I've seen this last year on the planet. Let me go further. Well, I'll bring you now to Asia in that way. And to show you, say what's happening over there. In a couple of ways to see that. Here it is. Taipei. We are asked to make in the Museum of Tomorrow a next step after what this person did. And we should relate ourselves to the city for another statement than 101. So what's next? This is the site. And if you make the X-ray of the site, you see individual practices. This is quite nice, this X-ray. So, and it's somehow a comment of an urban development which is happening now over there. You can see that in this demonstration, one guy lived in a nice house, nice neighborhood, but it's kind of, these monsters are going to happen now. And they're passing by in Southeast Asia with millions at the moment, with a horror that I cannot imagine, which is beyond any quality. Yeah, some gold there in it. But this is the issue. How can we deal with that? And if you go there, again, this couple looking to diversity, what is now my thing? Type A, type B, type C? And that at the moment that there are many companies much smarter dealing with diversity in that way, we could learn from that. So how to do that? Making more types of housing. This is a normal one, a classical one, one with a tower, one a twin set, a hip one, a factory, even hipper, a Catholic one, a barn, a courtyard house, a runaround. No, you can go on. You can create it, of course, with material, with landscapes, with more fences. If you then start to make that list, then you have choices on different scales. And it was nice to see the first, say, choices of, say, about 20 people that choose these. Okay, fine, fair. And then you have quite a cool block, I would say, where you can walk around, and it's which is a vertical village, as we call it. And it's also a comment, maybe to Herzog & Dumeron, to Vitra, which is very beautiful, but it's a one building. This is urbanism. So this is another. So urbanism again is very important to imagine. So what's next? We waited for 2 years. We did some research further, and now with 50 people, it's going to be this. So this is nice because now you see also the environment. The block attack has also appeared over there. This is the contrast, and this is the dream that we would like to pursue in that way. So what's next? In Jakarta at the moment, similar enterprise, one could say. Here you can see the images of the newspaper and. And what is here, this is Jakarta, is flat. Kampungs, villages everywhere. Beautiful social entities, to be honest. You walk on the street, there are cows, there is everyone you can... But traffic-wise, horrible. And of course, hygiene-wise, intensely problematic. So it's good that they investigate intensification by new metro lines. And that causes like moments of intensification. How to do that? If with this first intensification, what does the president like? And yes, something that is not like the Twin Towers of Petronas in Kuala Lumpur. Of course not. Should not look like that. So how to build up a rhetoric for him is what it wants to say. It's on the place of this Rupia factory, and the surrounding looks like this. All these kind of blocks that are there, 2, 3, 4 stories high. So what we try to do, basically, with the same typology, we blend them together here with Jordi to make it in a tower. That's all. So how to do that? How can, in a cheap economy, you could do this, is what it wants to say. It's not so complicated. This is the site. This is the pavement you need to keep. This is the FAR, the program. You dig out, you put a parking with an entrance to the metro, you add your retail basement, you make blocks out of the new retail, put it in between, put some extra retail on top. Do it the same with the entertainment blocks of all the cinemas by MGM, pack like this, and get rid of all the same housing by different neighborhoods you want to see. Add some office blocks, and top it up with a Marriott hotel. So that's all what you need to do. And then suddenly, of course, you can cover it with green. If more roofs, that's crucial. I tell you why. Because I come back to that later, to cool the building. You always wonder, why can you build that, or is it possible? So the client said maximum 10% of steel. So the problem is maybe not so big. It's only one high rise, and the rest is mid rise. Okay, that helped. Second analysis, we only make 4 towers. What it says. So we can do it easily, because this is then the bridge structures. Okay, 10%, what it wants to be. And with the cantilevers and the smaller ones. And then this is built out of simple supercores, surrounded with super columns in that way, and then add this steel to it, and that's it. And that's why it's now possible, even on that kind of circumstances. There is a difference because of program and different of facades to that. That's okay, like that, treated in different manners. And with all the treatments of the... It causes a self-shading, which in that kind of circumstance is quite, as you know, also important. And the creation of this vertical jungle with the water retention causes a kind of airflow, which we can avoid an internal mall. Because that would be, of course, horrible to get that and to look at it. And then we have this micro. We make some destinations in it, and then this is the building. Well, that's all. Not mere, and you can walk around from the bottom to the top, over the cinemas, to the Soho block on that area, to the Sawa block on that side, and get it in, and then it blends in as a steeped hack of building program on this area. And it tries to summarize the city. It tries to turn it into energy and make it a symbol of that act, is what it wants to say. I take you to Beijing for a moment, to the latest project that we are doing. Here it is. To another site, and to show you that also, even here, it's good to think about Asia. Because when I arrived, I told the people, should I show this? But yes, it should. Because it's good that we all think about the global aspects, and we can learn from that. It's next to Tiananmen Square, where Mao is there, here's on the other side, and they have this, what we call hutong, over there. And it looks like that. It's quite cute, but it's a ruin. Kept for ages to be waiting for development. So what can we do with that area? So the hutongs were beautiful. When your filmmakers made these gorgeous films over there, and based on it, it became this kind of traditions came out of it, is what we know. And there is a decay, as I said before, by this kind of monsters. There's a comeback at the moment, where Disneyfication is taking over in a gigantic manner after the Olympic Games in Beijing and in Shanghai on this kind of elements. They are going on with this kind of copycats, to make this kind of structure. And this is hilarious. You see the block attack and the repair and the remake the hutongs before it. So, okay, what's next? It's good to think about new urban neighborhoods, because new urban neighborhoods are quite cool and they generate new economies, like this one in Seoul, this one in Paris, this one in New York, or this one in Amsterdam. So based on that, we can learn from that, as Saskia Sassen is already predicting in one of her books 10 years ago. So why not continuing that? So this is what happened in the last 10 years on that site. They cut through it, they added blocks, and we were working on different hypotheses to imagine how to make more density in this area. High rises, here's the hutong, and put high rises below, and you lift the whole hutong up, it looks like this, there's your hutong. Or combine it with a slope, so that you have the hutong, and put it on top of a mall, like this, not bad. Or you dig it in, and you have, say, basically glass streets, where you can look down into the mall. Or here we learn again from Italy, to turn it into the Forum Romanum of Beijing, by allowing it for simply ruinification in a beautiful way. Could have been, your Forum Romanum delivers more money than an intense area in New York. So it, but they didn't choose for this. So that would, and or to do more with all people. This is a new law in China, of course, to imagine a variety. They came up with, actually they loved that last one. They say, can you combine it with intensity? So we make a series of projects at the moment, a choreography. What's urbanism? You come up with a kind of idea now, what makes sense at that plot, to keep the structure of the hutong, but to let it be interpreted in a rich way. 1,700 courtyard houses. So you, some of them, they are simply preservation. Of course, you start with that because then you have done that. And that's so the series of projects look like that. Okay, fine. You also make space for interpretation. Because I think history is not only, it's also something that we could interpret in different ways. And I'll show you some examples in the future. You're a printed house in the same way that we do in Schijndel. Or the communication project, where we use it for advertisement. And here a shop by Jensen, how it would look like if we mirrorize completely one of the hutong houses. Or the green projects, how they contribute with the gardens to the environment. How the river project could be made, there it is, and the houses somehow illustrate how you could live with that in old hutongs, but then in glass, in a way. The passage project, where you extend the shopping into one piece, like with this kind of environment that you cut through the hutongs and suddenly have advertisements. Of course, we need to densify it here and there in different ways, by stacking it, by flipping it, by, this is a very beautiful one, to advertise basically that I'm there. Or the deeper project, where we dig into it, which looks like this. The parking project, my favorite somehow, because yes, we can do it in different ways. You can see it here. I love the one on the, that one here, that's good. You go in, then the house goes up and the house goes down. So it is, and the amenities, of course, to continue with all the developments of the kindergarten, the library project by Matt, architects, a very nice way, very subtle one. The sustainability projects that are there for food and for energy. So, and all together, it's what they want to be. That is what we want to do. 1,700 authors, 1,700 programs, 1,700 interpretations, and that leads to this. So what's next then? So you communicate then, in this next hutong, that in a kind of film that we are now making, where in a way this hutong describes itself through all this interpretation that I just presented. And it becomes like, okay, filmic. Second thing is, of course, to communicate with people, to advertise it. So we made this lanterns for every house that you can see from below, where you can see how a house would look like and what kind of would be lifted. This helped so much, I can show you, because somehow even the extreme ones were like adored and loved by the president, because after CCTV, he wants to have something Chinese. And this, he gets a combination of the two. And that is what he wants. So here it's hanging on the streets. We invited people, and you can, and of course the leaders in China, and celebrate that moment and to advertise it. So then we could, the money was there to make the office, to start with the first street in that way, and select two projects for that, or a couple of projects, to build in this street. So I show you one, the mirror house, yes, it's there, almost, it's on the, here it comes. So it looks like this. It's this spot, there it's divided, and here how we could do it in that way, and how it starts to imagine this kind of, say, sceneries as such with Jensen. Not too much on the outside, of course, But, so what's the next? Of course, how to do it in a Chinese way. So here are the stones that you find on site, the wood that we do. And then you, with this guy, no mask, they to work on that. And, but he's cool. He really makes this kind of beauties, suddenly, with that. This is wood that petrifies by the spraying act in that way, and it stays like this, and that turns into this kind of bricks on that way. Wow. I wished that Amsterdam would have looked like that, and is what it wants to say. I will come back to that later, in that way. So this is, and then here's on the production, and how the stones are now carried out. So what's next? The casted house. Another one that we love from one of the artists that has done this before, and that we try to imagine what can we do in this kind of circumstances. This spot looks like this at the moment. What can we do? So the concept is to rebuild the old houses, simply in a kind of cheap wood, and then to cut it on the side, then to pour concrete over it, like buri, in a way. And then even more and more in that way, and then it's stable. And then we can get rid of the houses below by burning them and finish it. So that would look like that at that moment. So what is the first message that you would see at that moment? And when you come from Mao the next time, and around the corner, you see this memory of the old houses that were there on that spot, and that become rooms where even you can look down to the cellar and float over this Chinese earth, is what it wants to say. So this shows, and this is the project where it is now going, what you are doing also in Rome or here in the town, and then to turn it into something which is visible, which is experimental also, which makes it vivid, which gives energy and beauty in a very wide way, is what this wants to say, this project. And now I bring you back to Europe. Let's bring to that this year. Because we can learn from Beijing. And I take you to Schijndel. Schijndel is my hometown. You don't know it, but that's okay. I lived there for 18 years. And my hometown was very ugly. And it's my parents lived there, my friends lived there, don't worry. And it was bombarded by the Americans just before it was liberated. So what can we do in that spot? I was angry with that. I didn't like to live there, but I loved the people. What can I do? I wrote a letter when I was 18 and said to the mayor, "Mayor, this is horrendous. What can't we do something about it? Can't you invite some architects to speculate on it?" And the mayor was very nice. He wrote a letter back and he said, "Yeah, Mr. Maas, very nice idea. I will come back to you." That took 30 years. And what was the next? He said, yeah, now you have made a market hall, blah, blah, blah. What can we do? Okay. Well, look at it. What is this? This is the old plan, the bombardment, bang. How it looked, the Americans, and then the Dutch designers. Horrible plan, sir. And what to do? So when this was the old situation, and this and the bombardment and the post-war elements, and the mayor said, "Yeah, what would you like to propose? I want to have attention." I said, "Ooh, vanity." And what to do then? He said, "Oh, I can give you a skyscraper. Then you have a." I love mayors that love skyscrapers. Especially that are ambitious. But anyway, you can see it from Antwerp, you can see it from Brussels, you can see it from Amsterdam, 400 meter high. And they took a team for a year on it, and then they talked about Kenneth and all the eldermen. In the end, no. One elderman had to go, and another one was fired. And so we have to, no. So the mayor said, "Maybe, Mr. Maas, maybe you give you the last chance. And now you have to come up with a proposal that we all love." How to do that? "You have to talk with all the politicians. There are in the Netherlands, there are 20 parties. Huh? So it's very simple." So they're here on a row. And what to do then? Huh? If you talk with you, "What do you want?" you say. And they say, "I want this." But you said, no, it should be this. And you say, "Okay, fair, somewhere in depth." And you can also, with the depth, huh? Same thing, come back to you. "No," like this. And height, the same as the neighbor, basically. But give some light to the street, because otherwise the streets are dark. So it was very funny, after, say, talking three times with them, three evenings, what it ended up. And suddenly you get this. That was like, it is very Freudian, I will show you. because this city, this village, looks like this everywhere. We can have hundreds of the same in that way. So we started to analyze all what they share, and to understand all these dots, and make pictures of it, map it, show it, and then turn it into knowledge. So many doors, so height, so much this, so much brick, so much that, and well calculated. And then in the end, we have the average farm, the average house. Interesting to see, it's half of the volume that they wanted. So I took the chance immediately to pop, to pump it up. And so that would mean that you have a farm with a door like this, Calimero, and it's like what it wants to be. And the mayor said, are you serious or is this ironic? What can I tell you? This is the politicians that have chosen it. And he told me, okay, this is, now, from now on, it's serious. I accept this self-criticism, this irony in that way, but you have to give me classical material. What's classical material? Now, bricks and straw and tiles. Yeah. I said, and glass? Yeah, glass also, no problem. So, that's it. So we did that. Here you see it happening. Windows, and there's completely out of glass at that moment. So we made with a photographer an interpretation of the average. We photographed all the farms, blended in our computers, put extra information in it, and burned it with Japanese technology into the glass at that moment. And that's all. So it becomes architecture of 2 millimeters. Some of you hate me for that, because that's a better answer to Venturi ever has made, I would say. So here, technology makes also that all the panels have to be choreographed. We have to organize render farms everywhere. We have to print it on time and to coordinate that. But the interior, of course, everywhere is the house. Everywhere is the average of scandal. And even the kitchens are connected to that. I can wash my hands and I'm still in that environment, it wants to say. Even bad interior architecture doesn't count anymore. You are overwhelmed by, hopefully, this trompe-l'œil, this picture, and this rose window that's over there. And of course, it's opened up. And the combination of small and big is hilarious. And the doors, and how we can imagine that even a commerce is participating in that the puppets react on the window in that way, and how the doors are made in that way, very thin. And this is, I think, my favorite image of scandal, somehow between new and old. It's evaporating or emerging, depends on your direction, and how we witness and look to it. How even this man with his bald hair becomes very attractive, I would say, and gets a point of theater at experience, but of course in the evening. What happens then? You know it. It becomes the lantern of the village. And somehow, it turns into a pride object at the moment. And now they love it. And now, yes, what's next in that way? You make it's a responsibility act. You say, give something which everyone, all the politicians, were very democratic, have chosen in a way, and was in a way the Trojan horse of newness. Yes, then there was some attention on the press, on the world press, and our mayor had to learn English. He didn't speak a word of it. So that, and that it is now kind of happening. The mayor of Amsterdam came, and he liked the building. I go to the south. There's something happening there. There's a glass building, and they tell me it's nice. And he said, I want to have something like that. He came back. So my mayor was very proud. Amsterdam is coming and to get to Amsterdam. So what is happening here? This is the shopping street called PC Hoofd. And it looks like this at the moment. This is our, say, Champs-Élysées. It's the Netherlands. I know. So what to do? It used to be a former street like that, very domestic. It turned in the 50s into something still in housing. And then the first companies came, the Gucci's, the Taras, they came in to get pieces. Very cute and small still, how that would work. What happens with the museums, so the state like the Rijks and others around it, that there's a lot of people are coming, more Chinese, more Russians than ever. And how to facilitate, and how Prada can now build their grand store, and how Gucci can do that, is the question what it refers to. And they all want to do something like this, to be transparent, say global, bling bling in a way, and on the other hand, local. How to combine these two? That is the formula. which I like, and to do something in that. So what can we do with these two guys here? This is where the data was sitting. We looked at the old drawings, and that was like this. It became then this in the 50s. And then this is the architect of Chanel, nota bene, was showing. And he said, I said, man, how can you do that? He came from New York. Huh? He thought that this was like the vernacular Amsterdam new style, where he interpreted modernity with context. Huh? He learned from you. And so what to do there? So he said, do this. Huh? So this is the drawing we gave to the beauty committee. And he said, wow, cool idea. Just pump up the, like in Schindel, the existing in that way and make it good. Okay. They said, we do it only when we do it with this. Can we do it? Because then you can look this. Then we can make a crystal house with gutters like this, with tiles like this. This would be fantastic. Mayer loved it. Better than Schindel, he said. That's cool. And it is a kind of a dream to make, say, when this is the Vondelpark, that we do something like this in between, in a way. So, and it can advertise, obviously, itself in the evening. But what's next? The beauty committee said no. Beauty committees are fantastic, I think. What is what is beauty? That's the discussion. And they are very strong in the Netherlands. They say, no, you are, it's a very nice design, but it should be a normal brick. I said, what? But the mayor liked it. No. This is our law, normal brick. But how much, then I asked. They don't know. So we calculated all the brick in the surroundings, in that way, 1 kilometer distance. And then the average amount of brick is 20%. So, okay, what happened then? If we apply the generic rule, what you want to apply on this, so you know already what's happening. I see your to face what we do. This is what we want, this is what they wanted, and they get this, basically. So that's all. So you have this, in that way. And that hasn't been translated now. It's one of the most expensive details. I come back to that, what has happened with this Chanel store. So what is then? Yeah, then you go to Italy, of course. Because who can do it? You go to Venice, to Burano, and you ask with this family, that brilliant family, and say, can you do it for us? Oh, no problem. Ages it took. Make one stone. 3 weeks later, it comes to the Netherlands. And I'm going, hey, Luigi, you have to speed up. No. But it starts. So here they come. Then we have to test how that will work, that it goes like this. So two of your dentists here in Italy came to the Netherlands, orthodontists, because they have the best glue. Yeah? When you make a crown, then it glues the best. So that's what you see them and how they are testing it with these machines, how we put it on the in the labs and to test it. Yeah, the graphs come out. It's positive. So it's stronger than even a hammer or other terrible people, if they go there into this facade, no crack at all is what it's going to be. Your glass is magnificent, but your dentists are better, is what it wants to say. So what to do? You calculate the forces. You need some extra columns in it. So here you see how that's produced, how they are tested, and that way, yeah, it works. No red. The wood, how that's under production, with all the other wooden elements and the beams, of course. You see the wood, how it's coming across. The beams, separate issue, how to make that, red zones, the alarm. So we have to develop them separately into that kind of these elements that now are like melt together into one element as such. And then, of course, the most expensive detail, how to make bricks into glass. Impossible. So we have to infiltrate completely the brick with glass in order to make that glue possible. And then what's next? Here I go to the site, you see it happening. We start with the bricks, then we start to blend it up with our dentist there, the two guys that are there. And then you see my favorite one. Because how to train people that somehow makes concrete normally? How to train them that they love glass? And every stone takes an hour and a half of keeping it like a monk to do that, and to touch it, tuck, with your fat fingers, to do that in that way. That, I think, is the beauty of the project. And in this case, also, again, the Italian dentists helped to form a good team with these people, and to turn it into this kind of gentle move into
Yeah.
It's the softest building that we ever have made. It took more than a year and a half to build it. My client was in panic, as you know, and had to rent temporarily another place. But somehow we were in love, and we started to consider this as a potential. So here it happens, how the first things appeared, how it gradually is under development, and now somehow it comes this kind of ice almost, that is permanently there, and that's stronger than ice, where you can probably see now the bricks glued in, and how it turns into this play, and how it gradually is there. So I invite you for the opening next Monday to be there, and to have a good drink with us, and to see how it's now in reality, as such. Wow. Of course, this is a starting point. As I said before with the research, next step, what is then? So I propose now to Chanel to make a new shop and to say, because the interior is horrendous, you will see it, but like a scandal, it doesn't matter. So what to do then? So could we imagine a shop where the products are better, where you can see it more closely in that? So we are aiming to make this, to make an environment where you continue with transparency. Beautifully done already through some of your designers here in your country, but it can be even more. If the floors are out of that, if the ceiling is out of that, if the walls are out of that, the neighbor also, I can look to that way, to a position in Asia, where you can watch the mountains in that moment. And then I can make the furniture like that, and I can make even the toilets like that. But where does this end? Where intimacy begins? In that way. So you see it here, everything was intimate, we clad it with mirrors in that way. So your clothes are doing that, and boop, it goes like this, the image, like beyond it. And that makes it, I think, even continuous. And of course we continue with design, we want to have cars like that, we want to have kitchens like that. In the next Biennale, I'm going to show you the glass kitchen that we are making at the moment. I'm not allowed to show it today, okay, but I'll raise a little bit that test where food is shown in the best way. Processing food is there, and you can see it in every detail, in a glass pipe, in a glass refrigerator, in a glass boiling act, in that way, because it's all the food that counts, not the stuff that we are making, and not that. So how to do that is what this questions, and hopefully leads to a momentum that density, I was talking about it, is combined with infinity, in a way. That somehow we can look further away is what it wants to be. Now, and then I end now. And with the last, say it's chapter of today's exercise, is, of course, with my current hometown, with Rotterdam, with the exhibition that we that people had organized last time, in, and where I want to take you, of course, to maybe the other method of making this infinity possible. This is the site, and you might have visited, you might have known it, but I want to tell you the story. I want to explain why it is as it is, and what is the simplicity or the complexity in it. It is, used to be the site in Rotterdam, and then of course this happened in the war, and flattened out this site exactly there, and we replaced it with buildings like this, with Maas Kant, one of my favorite architects. And he made something, many of like this, which are very concrete, but they're good. They're really, really fantastic to do. And Rotterdam did make the choice to make a collection, maybe like Beijing, but in this case without theme. And actually the architects were intelligent enough to make proposals every time that reacted nicely on the former one, without rule in that way. And that leads to this kind of collection of elements. They're not bad, honestly. They're quite cool. And they have different cultures and background, and different, say, usages as such. So what could be the next step in this operation? And we were brought to this site, this bombardment zone, where the new buildings are appearing. We said, can we make not more higher buildings around this plaza with the same proportions as in Siena? We used. Again, reference Italy. I'm going to make this exhibition in the future, because it is true that you may build up a very good collection of references, but somehow you don't continue, fair, but let's discuss that later. So let's hear the Siena thing and how it could be. And then we say, the mayor said, okay, a market hall. But how to do that? And my client, two investors, were like saying, yeah, we make houses, 250, and they pay for the market hall, and we do something like Miralles in Barcelona, so small. And I said, man, you can't do that because you want to advertise food. You want to advertise food production. You want to, this is the first market hall in the Netherlands. We have no culture about market halls. We go to France, we go to Spain, and we love food. But how to do that then in this case? We have to say, why can't we twist the guy in that way? Like in Torino, okay? So that's to learn from that. And then to have, to use your housing to cover it, basically. This is much too expensive. He said, no, you have more penthouses than everywhere. So you can sell it easily. Yeah, but this, they have no view. Okay, we make a view like this. Yeah, but then this is too expensive. I need too much steel to pay it off. And the rent should be low because it's social and middle class houses. Okay, Roman technology comes into it. Just the vault that makes it, where are my lifts? I cannot make lifts here. So okay, we punch it back and then it's done. And then the key, of course, is this structural diagram. Because the Netherlands is constructed with tunnels. Tunnel, and we make a tunnel, it's a house. Pour concrete over it, get the tunnel out, put it back. And we make concrete which is 25 centimeters deep. I go from XS to XL, don't worry. 25 centimeters? Why? Because I only need 14 centimeters for the wall. No, that's for acoustics, because I don't want to hear my neighbor, is what it says. But exactly this 11 centimeters extra, I can do this. I can put the tunnel out and put it a little bit further away. And I can use that extra to kiss. And that is what it then suddenly happened to do. A rough structure which didn't cost more, which was paid by the housing. And I have to do that because the tomatoes inside need to be the same price as outside. It is, Rotterdam is not posh. It is not Milan. We are like a kind of workers' class, Birmingham environment. So what can we do? So we cladded it with the tiles of the city. The same pavement goes over it, so it becomes more pop, I would say. And we go further into the detail. And we worked with Philips for a while on a kind of LCD facade. Any message could be done. Fruit can come, fall over you. Or you can have cathedrals of spaces. You can think about messages. The bananas are there, cheaper than there. Where is Dennis? Where are the parents of Dennis? All these kind of things were. So we worked a long time, 6 years with them, with Philips, to get it in price. From 30, they promised 35 million going down to more or less 4 or 5. Didn't work out. So at just before the starting of the construction, we had to change it. And I'll show you what we did with the artist. The dream was also to open the windows, so that you live behind the screen. You know this film, that you are living behind the Coca-Cola advertisement? This gives a kind of character in that way. But then you open Coca-Cola, the O is away, or the C is away, and then you can shout to your son downstairs, hey, come on, man, we need to eat, get the fish up. So that is what this is architecture that is not like a museum or like a little bit elitist environment. This is working with people in that way, but in such a way that that can be also iconic. Is that doable? Can you live in an icon? Or do we only live in modesty? No. I think in this case, modesty would not have worked in the end when I looked to it. So what happened? Do you see what we did? We placed the building away, a school away, we made this basement and then started to construct at that moment and made this kind of touching of the tunnels up to this moment. That is what it wants to be. At that moment, there happened something. Somehow, the world started to discover what's going on in Rotterdam. So they put it on the news, come to Rafa, our lovely title, and say, oh, there's something happening where they expect that there will be more visitors. They expected 50,000 extra to come. I come back to that, don't worry. So, and they put it already then in some lists to do that, and still the market hall in completion. So what's next? Of course, our queen is wonderful. She said, I want to come. I want to shop, I want to open the building. That is, so wow, that is super that she's coming. So here we had fun and talked about the building with each other. She did a marvelous opening act, almost like Cinderella, and walked around with the people. And then, of course, what's happening outside? That was the moment which was touching to me. And when they opened the doors, then this happened. Here, somehow, something went wrong in our design. Something, the firemen alarmed and were panicking, and at 10 o'clock in the evening closed the building, and we have to repair all the fire exhausters, all the door handles, in like overnight, to make this, instead of this small group of visitors, to have this almost this Walt Disney effect that happened with it. Same amount of people came there as in Euro Disney at the moment. And that I was starting to look at to this like this, shopping around, hanging out on the terraces. And yeah, this is also not bad, because you have different people. And with Herman, the Blacker, a very good cook, and he wanted to cook there, and he wanted to slaughter oxes. So blood is going over the floors. And how to make marble, travertine, you know, you're a specialist, to turn that into blood-protected areas. Now, that is, took another way to go, but it's there, with the different users that that we have now, the different market people, what they do, and how we somehow celebrate also the next level. So a market hall should be indeed, yes, minimally 60% should be for food selling, a maximum 40% for gourmet, and for because you see the market halls in Copenhagen and in Munich that are terrible, that are elitist places at the moment. Party poopers only go there and not say you go to shop there. Of course they're surrounded by this. And that is why this second layer is, at that moment only 3 terraces, now 10, 15 are coming now over it to make this second layer possible. And to then, of course, it's covered now with this. 2 stories. But what can replace Philips? Samsung? No, didn't work out. So we made with panels, we used Scheindel again. We burned the technique into aluminum, similarly in Japan, to do it rapidly. We got a good price. We had a discussion, what the client said, can you give me an image? I said, what? Yeah, you can bring it from the internet. I said, there's 11,000 square meters of picture. If I take something from the internet, then you don't see what it is. The pixel sizes are bigger than the panels. So that's stupid. Oh, what do we have to do? We have to get render farms as rapid as possible over the planet. Toronto, Auckland, they were all working on this in 2-3 months to do it. And get an artist to do that. A competition between artists. Artist, art, and for a developer that has no taste. What can you do? So, and ultimately, he brought it into the, this man has made this perspective. We sent the group to Roma, to the San Lorenzo, to sit down for a while and to look at your beautiful trompe l'oeil in a day and say, that's what we want to do. Maybe in a pop way, maybe with shrimps or with bananas, and you live behind the shrimp. And the second element of this, what's important, is the window. Because for now, I can look to people that live there, that go to a bathroom or to a toilet and that have dinners over there, and that explains then the vulnerability of that. So that's what, this is the most important part of the building, that I can look down at 3 layers of glass, no smell in it, and 250 people that say to the developer, you can't change what you're doing there. They protect and turn it into a public, if not collective, space, is what they are doing to do. And then you sleep next to it. You have this kind of paintings in your room. You have this kind of backdrop of your dining table or your backdrop of your working spaces. You love to watch, even from the entrance halls, and have this always, gratuitly, this is your address. And with even, I mean, furniture, what is this? This is middle class, lower middle class in Rotterdam. What you can do, but they are proud on what they have here, and how you can look down on the market hall, and how your children can play on 40 meter high, and how somehow danger is accompanied with comfort and vulnerability. That is the vulnerability that is symbolized in this project. And ultimately, this window is the most important, because that creates an urban space before it that is heated during day and night somehow, and where this cold city of Rotterdam suddenly becomes warmer and has this kind of, say, usage, what it wants to say. This picture point is then the result. And it's a bent, what can we learn from it? It's a bent building, a skyscraper. It's a porous building, in the best, and hopefully in the same way I explained with the porous city, that is now not a high rise, but density that's combined with openness. And what is there next to end with? Of course, this went over the planet, with this kind of images over there, with this kind of amount of visitors and control acts that we have to do, getting into lists, getting into guidebooks. I didn't expect that at all, to be honest. You never can expect that. And what is next? I think this is what touches me more. That Rotterdammers use it now. Hey, Turkish weddings are at that spot. that the marathon is there, and that teachers, here it says, say, this is possibly made by teachers like you, it was, it says, in the campaign of social affairs. That is what this building somehow has demonstrated. Okay, Jamie is also in, no problem in that. But of course, and now it's reaching further in its destinations. And with that, I hope that I gave you a series of thoughts on what architecture can do with the city, why this is Rotterdamish, and why it worked in that place, and why, therefore, it gave something to that city. I did it with architecture, I did it with urbanism, and I did it with research. It took me, and that leads hopefully to a next city generation with this great wish list. And with that, I hope to see you soon again.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Opera, no? Opera, sì.
Thank you, Winy.
Thank you very much.
I know we're late, siamo in ritardo, ma li faremo mangiare un secondo di meno a... we have 10 minutes, abbiamo 10 minuti al massimo per domande, eccetera, però vorrei che li sfruttassimo.
Really congratulations for this. You portrayed several ideas of your ideal cities. Which could be the role of light in all this? A simple question.
Well, there are two types of light, natural light and artificial light. And of course, this has a reason to speak about. Well, light is light, is leggero. So it makes it, it's a material, of course, which you need and which helps enormously. Well, without that, I can't work, obviously. But I didn't show any piece of illumination in my lecture. So somehow, I didn't need to explain it. Or I did not show that it should be in such a way that you don't see it. That's the question. So that it's light has its lightness, ultimately. And that it finds its path. And that's ultimately, of course, the art of light that we have to see. Why I don't see it as a subject? Because there are more important elements than light. There are more messages. There are more pieces of urbanism. But it helps. And it makes it more profound. So I'm not Bruno Taut, that is maybe like showing what the light could be. But on the other hand, I think when we can use it in this subtle manner, then we can it can help us to advocate bigger urban agendas.
Okay, let's do this.
Ciao.
Yeah.
But I can translate.
No, I have.
Do you think that in Italy, is there any kind of fear to experiment with the new architecture because it's new modern architecture? For example, in Italy, every time they propose a kind of a new architecture, it's always rejected because they say it will ruin the relationship with the surroundings or could not be up to the level, for example, of the monuments, historical monuments of our towns. So what do you think? What is the reason why in Italy there is almost no experimentation in terms of new architecture? Is that fear from our politicians or leaders,
political
leaders?
You made also quite a lot of mistakes in the past. You have this reaction came from the fact that you have made peripheries that are really ugly. If I go to Sicily and I drive through these areas, then I wonder where the beautiful landscape is. That's really one. If I drive to the Po area, then I become very angry in that way. So you covered. And we have to calculate it. I think that's what the schools should do. How many percent of your country is ugly in that way? And on the other hand, you are aware that the beautiful parts are extremely needed for your economy. Eh? You attract tourists with that. You sell products with that. So this this configuration makes that. So how to deal with that is your question. because so it's explainable. And I hope I can give you some strategies. I cannot give you further reasons for that. We didn't build anything here. Maybe that's the reason also, because it's that fear over there. But I find it funny that you do that. And I do hope that you somehow find a way to discuss this better. But you, as a school, have to come up with proposals for Roma. I want to see what you are going to do with that. Because they don't do it, so you'd have to show what is good for that place. You guys are making proposals for this area to see what you want for continuity. I don't say that every new modernity is good. There are fantastic modern masters in your country. I adore Nervi, and I think the Market Hall is also for him in a kind of reference. But there are also like this other 99% of modernists that somehow didn't do a good job. That somehow, and now we're suffering from that. And
can
that's what you.
Can I add something?
Yeah.
Posso dire una cosa? Per dire la verità.
Well, to tell the truth.
This narrative. Of all questa narrativa del
contesto,
del
context, the new and the old, the classical. This is a kind of a big lie that is used to cover a power gain, you know. Those who wanted to keep power in architecture, they have taken advantage of this contrast. But it's a kind of a story, it's a kind of a legend, it's a kind of a construction made. If you don't want things to happen, you know, you find a lot of ways.
So it's so easy to understand.
Any other question?
Which is very true. I acknowledge if there is energy, you can do it. And if there's a wish, you can do it. You have to go further with it. Please. Time is finished, eh? We have to leave.
Vini.
Grazie.
Last question.
So I teach to these kids, to these students, the success of your architecture, is it related to the handcrafts, to the artisan knowledge, for example, knowing the materials, knowing the technology, and what is the relation with the craftsman, with the people that actually give life, beauty, and efficacy to your construction, to your creations?
I hope that I showed, especially with the Chanel house and also with the Market Hall, how much you have to put in to work with, in this case, the glass makers, or in the case of the Market Hall, the printers. And you don't know how many tests have been made with the printing to get this perfect composition that can go through time in that way. So every desire has a lot of, say, it needs a lot of energy with the specialists to make this possible. So, of course, these buildings also are indeed for them, and that costs also time. And maybe, Jan, you can calculate the amount of time we spent on this and to compare that with our fees, so that somehow this makes also an illustration for that. And on the other hand, you don't have to do that. Standard elements are also there. Per building, I can afford maybe one issue in the budgets to do that. One zone, one panel, one piece of glass, and that's also a way of dealing with it. These specialists, as you were looking at, then are only working on that component to make that element. That's what you cannot more afford, okay?
Vini, come here. Grazie.
You have to go, eh?
Thank you, Winy. Thank you so much.
Very good.